Hello. Today we're going to talk about all the things inside of us that want to take charge and want to take over. So I'm sure you've had the feeling, especially when you're sad or you're angry, that you get and you just want to lash out or you want to. But then there's another part of you that can tell you to calm down. And sometimes there are things you want to say, and there's another part of you that tells you not to say that. So we're going to talk about that kind of self-control and the parts of you, those inner voices that you have that want to have control and want to tell you what to do. So here's a little story about two children named Tim and Jim. Tim and John were twin brothers, and they were a lot alike. They looked alike, and they talked alike, and they often dressed alike. But there were a few ways that they were different. Tim loved pancakes for breakfast, and John loved waffles. Tim loved to read mystery stories, and John liked adventure stories. They both enjoyed camping, but Tim loved to camp near the lake, and John loved to camp in the woods. Their parents found the perfect place to camp, near a lake and near the woods. After a long weekend of camping fun, the boys were walking through the woods on the trail that led to their campsite when they heard a loud rustling in the bushes. Tim stopped and squeaked in a scared voice, "What is it?" John spoke calmly, but his eyes were wide. "It sounds big." In the next moment, they heard more rustling and a low growl. "Run!" yelled Tim as he took off down the trail at lightning speed. John was more than willing to follow him, but his shoelaces were loose and he was flat on the ground after just a few steps. He looked behind to see what was coming out of the bushes, and instantly he recognized the huge feet and the claws, the coarse brown fur, and the massive head and jaw of a bear. The bear came at him fast. There was no time to get up and run. John wanted to yell for help, but something inside told him not to. He remembered an adventure story he read about a guy who survived a bear attack because he kept still and quiet. Bears aren't interested in things that are dead or appear to be dead, so John lay on the ground where he fell, and he kept perfectly still as the bear ran up to him and stopped with his huge head hanging over John's little head. Tim ran until he realized John was not with him. When he looked back to see the bear leaning over John, he screamed and he started to go back. But as he got closer, the bear looked so huge and scary that Tim climbed up the nearest tree instead. From his perch high in the tree, he could see the bear sniffing John all over, and Tim started yelling, "Get out of here, bear! That's my brother, not bear food." John could feel the bear's hot breath on his neck as the bear sniffed him from head to toe. The bear made loud snuffling noises, and the air was full of hot bear smell. John tried not to breathe, but he had to, at least a little. Inside John, there was a battle going on. Part of John wanted to cry and call for help. Part of John could hear Tim yelling and wanted to tell him to be quiet. There was even a little part of him that wanted to look up and see how big the bear's teeth were. But the part of John that won the battle was the part that knew it was best to be still and hope the bear would go away. The bear reached out with its powerful paw and pushed John's leg. He felt sharp claws rip into his pants. He did not want to think about how scared he was and how sad his mom and dad would be if he died, so he focused instead on another thought. Well, now Tim's pants and my pants won't look alike anymore. He thought about kicking the bear in the nose. He thought of yelling, "Go away, bear!" But John just let his leg be pushed as if he were dead and he couldn't move it himself. From the tree, Tim kept calling and crying, "John, John, are you okay?" And then he pulled some pine cones off the tree and started to throw them at the bear. He called for his mom and dad, but they were too far away to hear. The bear nudged John with his big black nose. John felt the bear's wet nose through his shirt, and part of him wanted to say, "Go slobber somewhere else, bear," but he just lay still. The bear paused and looked around, and John suddenly thought about Tim. He wanted to look for Tim and call out to him to be quiet and to stay up in the tree, but he made himself be still and keep calm. It felt like a very long time before the bear seemed to decide that there was nothing more to do, and it moved away. It stopped under Tim's tree and looked up at him. Tim climbed higher, yelling all the time, "Go away, bear, or I'll come down there and beat you up. If you hurt my brother, I'll turn you into a bear rug." Tim didn't come down from the tree until he saw the bear disappear, and then he ran to John, who was slowly getting up from the ground. After Tim hugged his brother, he said, "Wow, did you see that? I scared that big old bear away. Wait till we tell Mom and Dad." And now I have some questions about this story. The first one is, you know, Tim was up in that tree and he was throwing pine cones. But do you think he really scared the bear away? Was he the reason that the bear left? No, I don't think so either. I think that bear just left when it felt like it, not because of anything that Tim did. And what do you think made the bear go away without hurting John, at least not hurting him too much? Yeah, some people say that if you are perfectly still and you play like you're dead, that bears don't have any interest in that. And so the bear kind of sniffed around and thought that John wasn't alive. Can you imagine how he must have been breathing? Just really shallow, like. Not hardly at all, but not like. Right? He had to be really still. And because John was so still, that maybe that's why the bear left. Yeah, and what do you think was the hardest thing that John had to do? I can think of a lot of things that were hard about that. Not crying or freaking out or whimpering. Not shaking. Not breathing too deep. Not screaming back at his brother. Like, there were a lot of things about that were hard for John, right? In that moment when John was laying down and the bear was over him, he needed an inner leader. He needed a voice inside of him to lead him, to give himself control and to lead. And sometimes that's what we need. And that's what we're working on in church and in Sunday school all the time, is that we're working on our inner leader. We're working on our inner person and our inner voices that tell us, the ones that tell us to love and to have control, self-control, to be patient, to be calm. And boy, those things really paid off for John in this story. And just another thing I want to say about this story, it's really never a good idea to run from a bear. That's not a good idea. Like, what Tim did was really, really dangerous. And he climbed up into a tree. But guess what? Bears are really good climbers. Like, he was really, really lucky in this story. And I also want to say that this is just a story. This didn't happen. And whenever we're hiking or camping, especially when we're going to the Rockies where we know that bears live, that we should review our bear safety. And we can find bear safety from Canada National Parks. And it's a good idea to use your inner leader before you go hiking. Ask your family to review bear safety and to review safety on the trails. So today we're talking about our inner leader, and we're talking about which of your inner voices is in charge of you from time to time. And so I have a little game. It's actually more like an exercise. It's a thing you can do at home to develop your inner leader and to develop your control and your sense of control. So I have a plastic bucket that's here. And I also have three little bean bags. And so you want to get yourself something plastic like that can be your target. You don't want it to be anything that can break. And then you want to get something you can toss. You don't have to be bean bags, but they could be like bottle caps from a milk jug or a juice jug Or if you have little stuffed animals like Beanie Babies, you could use those. The things aren't going to get hurt, but you want something you could throw that's not going to break and something that's not going to hurt anything around. And so the exercise goes like this. You're going to start out facing your target, and just as slow as you can, like I want to concentrate on where that target is. It's really important in this first part of the exercise to take some time concentrating about just getting in your mind how far that target is from you and how you think you're going to need to toss to make it into that target. So spend some time just kind of judging that distance, and then you're going to take your objects and just try to toss them into the target. And you'll notice that when you're looking at the target, like, it's pretty easy for me to toss all of those in there. You might have noticed that the last one hit the rim, but the other two didn't even hit the rim. They just went right in the bucket. And you want to practice that a couple of times, get used to that distance, because then what you're going to do is don't look. Now, I know where that target is because I just practiced a little bit, but I'm going to toss behind my back and try to make those into the target. That sounded like it didn't go. That sounded like it was too short. I can't tell. It sounded like it hit the floor. Okay, so when I look back, I threw them all to the same side, right? See how they all kind of went in the same place? I'm going to try again, but I'm going to factor in into my stillness that I threw them in that direction. I'm going to throw with the same hand, see if I can correct that. So remember, I know how far I am. Now I know I was off. I'm just going to be still and see if my inner leader can correct that. That sounds like it went the other way. Okay, so see, I'm all over the place. But that's the game for today. That's the exercise. So maybe because I'm so off, I might want to practice again facing my target before I turn around and face the other way. So see if you can work on that and see what your inner leader or your inner voice is saying to you. Keep your inner voice saying good things to you about just correcting your course. And just remember what happened to John in the story and how he needed that inner leader in that moment that was so dangerous for him. There are conversations we can have with ourselves and exercises that we can do to help our inner leader get strong and help us so that if we're ever in trouble, that inner leader can take over. You might have noticed that when I was doing that exercise, you might have noticed two things. Number one, I never made it in the target when I had my back turned. Did you notice that? I didn't spend enough time to get that down so that I could make it when I wasn't looking. But secondly, I never told myself, I'm no good at this. I can't do this. I never said that to myself. What I was saying is, oh, I'm throwing too far to the right or too far to the left. So let me concentrate a little bit further so that I can practice trying to get that more in the middle. That's what I was saying to myself. And that's a skill that I learned from listening to people that love me, from paying attention to people that love me. So the people around me that love me, they encourage me to develop my inner leader, and they teach me to have confidence and self-esteem so that I don't say things to myself that are mean or that put me down or that don't help me build my inner leader. So the people that I listen to, the people that love me, I listened to Pastor Phil and to my sons, but I also listened all my life to my parents and to my teachers and to my mentors and my coaches. Those are the people that helped build me up. And especially I listened to my pastor because my pastor helps me listen to Jesus. And Jesus is the one who's always building us up. Jesus is the one who's always loving us. In fact, you know that song, Jesus Loves Me. It says, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. And Jesus tells us that the things that we think about and the way that we spend our time, the things that we tell ourselves about ourselves, matter. And so Pastor Phil has a song
about what we think about. It's a song you've heard a lot, and he's going to sing Thinkin'. Oh, I wanted to tell you that Pastor Phil recorded Thinkin' when he was working on a lesson about forgiveness. So he's going to talk about that in the song. But that's okay, because forgiveness is a good thing to think about. That builds our inner leader too.
I thought we'd do the Thinkin' song again. So here it goes like this. Thinkin' about thinking, 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 thinking about thinking, 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 thinking about thinking in our song. Tell it to the people as we pass it along. Sing glory, 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 hallelujah. Shall we think about today? Well, we're going to think about God. Let's think about God. Thinking about God, 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 God. Thinking about God, 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 God. Thinking about God in our song. Tell it to the people as we pass it along. Sing glory, 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 hallelujah. Our song, do do wop, do do wop, do do wop. So it's Sunday, but I know that school started. I'm gonna think about school a little bit. Thinking about school, 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 school. Thinking about school, 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 school. Thinking about school in our song. Tell it to the people as we pass it along. Sing glory. Talking about thinking about forgiveness. That's a big mouth word. I mean, a lot of syllables in there. Think we can do that one? Let's think. Let's try it. Thinking about forgiveness, 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 forgiveness. Whew. Thinking about forgiveness, 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 forgiveness. Thinking about forgiveness in our song. Tell it to the people as we pass it along. Sing glory, 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 hallelujah. Praise the Lord in our song. Do do wop, do do wop, do do wop.
Let's close our time together with a short prayer. And we'll do what we call a peat and repeat prayer, which means I'll say a line and then you can say the line after me. Let's pray. God, thank you for being good to us. Thank you for giving us friends and parents and teachers and coaches. People who help strengthen our inner leader. And we especially thank you for Jesus, who teaches us to love others and love ourselves. Help us to love others and love ourselves. Amen. All right, have a good day. See you next time.